So today we like to know about Informatica MDM architecture. So let's try to write down Informatica MDM. So what is the full form of MDM? It's nothing but Master Data Management. So in this session you are trying to learn Informatica MDM architecture. So why we need this architecture to learn? So as a developer, everybody should learn Informatica MDM architecture, because this architecture explains us from where does we get the data from and where does it go from stage by stage, and finally where it sits in that different tables of MDM. So let's start the architecture so that you can have a brief idea on the data flow, what happens in our MDM Informatica. So this is the architecture over here, you can see on the screen. So this is the batch flow. So this is a batch data process flow. So this is the architecture about I'm talking, where each and every developer should learn, because it contains all each and every details, how the data flows, and finally what Informatica MDM developer does. Okay, so if you see here, you can see two sources over here, two red bulbs over here. This is nothing but a source system. So first of all, what is a source system? So let's try to see that. So source system is nothing but it is a place where the data is being generated. It's a place where the data has been generated. So what do we mean by data is generated? For example, let's go with small example like some kind of telecom domain, some kind of operator, service operator. So this service operator, I can select operator. So this operator can provide multiple services like prepaid SIMs, or like he can provide like postpaid SIMs, or also he can provide the different kind of services like broadband services. So these are the different services provided by a telecom operator. So now suppose a customer called John went to a particular store. So think that he went to a store one and he purchased a prepaid SIM. So now once he purchased a prepaid SIM, so it's not only like just giving the money, they'll give us the SIM. Apart from the money, we also need to provide the documents as a proof, so that who is the person is using this particular SIM card, right? For that reason being, we need to provide the documents. For that reason being, we here have the data like John, think that his address is like Pittsburgh, and something is phone number, maybe like a 203 or something. This is a phone number. Okay, this is a phone number. So now, so what's happening here? Here, I can say that at store one, since you purchased a prepaid SIM, you also provide this kind of information to your store here. So that is how our data has been generated at store one. Similar to that, supposing that the same John went to some other store and he purchased a postpaid SIM. So in this scenario as well, apart from your money, you also need to provide the same detailed information over here, correct? So here also I have like, suppose John K, and he said like some street, comma Pittsburgh, and here is phone number. Again, his phone number is provided over here. So what's happened here again? Anyway, that's store two, a data has been generated. So simply purchasing the postpaid SIM, in return, apart from money, what we did, we just John has provided the details to the store two as well. Similarly, at store three as well, if you want to have some broadband services from the same operator, yes, you can also, you need to provide the documentation part again for the broadband services thing over here. So what's happening here? The data is being generated at the different stores, or I can say that the store is nothing but it is your source system. So at your source system, you will be getting your data get generated over here. So this is nothing but your source systems over here. Now, how the data which has been generated or which has been created at my stores or at my source system, how this data is been getting into my Informatica Hub console? So that is the question in here. So in general, comparing to with your Informatica Power Center, Informatica Power Center can read the data from any kind of source system. Like it can, the source system can be a flat file, the source system can be your relational tables, like it can be Oracle database, it can be your Teradata database, it can be any kind of source system. Informatica, yes, it Power Center can read the data, but Informatica Master Data Management, Informatica MDM, does not have any option to read the data from any kind of source system. So at stores, which I told here, the data in here, they may be storing in flat files, or in here they may be storing the data in some Oracle database, or in here this may be storing the data in Teradata database. So here I'm having three kind of source system. So one is like flat files, and here Oracle, and here they store the data in Teradata database. So then how, if the Informatica MDM does not have any option to read the data, then how could this data be inserted or it been pushed to my MDM level? So that can be done via two things here. The one thing is like it's called as a batch mode, and the other thing is like we called as a real time mode. So one is batch mode, another one is real time mode. So using this either of the mode, what we try to do is like we try to read the data from different source systems which you see in the screen here, and we push the data to our MDM, as MDM does not have any option to read the data. So now what is a batch mode here? So let's see about this first. So batch mode is nothing but it is a scheduled one. It's a scheduled one. So in general, in a project level, we'll be talking about our frequencies. So people, anybody ask like, what is your frequency of in your project? That means when you are trying to run your jobs, or when you are trying to extract the data from the source system and push the data to your target after applying your main business rules. So when you're trying to do this such kind of things. So in general, you may be having like daily or weekly or something like monthly. Sometimes it will be like quarterly even, and finally yearly as well. Yearly as well. Okay. So this is like kind of saying that I have, it is like a scheduled one. So suppose if you say like it's a monthly, I would say that suppose my data runs every month every month in the first of every month morning 6 a.m. that's my scheduled one. So every month in the first calendar day or first business day, it runs in the early morning 6 a.m. that is the scheduled one. So until that particular part, suppose I'm talking about January month, so from Jan 1st to Jan 31st, I will store my data in my source systems, and when I get my February 1st at the in the early morning 6 a.m. I'll start loading my whole January month data right from Jan 1st to Jan 31st into my MDM level. That's how it's a scheduled one, right? That's how it works. So when I go with my batch mode, so it is always a scheduled one. So to run these jobs, getting the data from my source systems into my MDM, to run these jobs, we use like ETL. It is nothing but it's extract, transform, and finally load the data. So this is a ETL process. So generally we go with any kind of ETL tool. So in general, when you go use your Informatica MDM, people uses like Informatica Power Center. People uses maximum Informatica Power Center. Else you may also use data stage or like ODI or like ab initio. So all these are nothing but different ETL tools where it helps us to read the data from my source system and finally push my data into my MDM Hub console. So this pushing of data, extracting or pushing of data will be done every monthly once when you go with your monthly frequency. If I say it's a weekly, weekly once at a particular moment, interval of time. Similarly, when I say it's daily, daily once at a particular exact time. So that's how it works when you go with your batch mode. Okay. So now coming to my real-time mode. So this is not like a scheduled one, but this is like immediate effect once a change happened at your source system. Suppose I took my John here. So this John had become like there is a change in the name like John K. Suppose. So earlier it was only John. Now it became like John K. So this is the update happened at my source system. So now once there is an update at my source system, this update should be immediately referred in my MDM Hub console. So that can be done via your real-time mode. So this is not a scheduled one. So I can say this is not a scheduled one. So this can happen at any time. These jobs will run at any time. So it's not like daily basis or weekly basis. So this can happen at any time. Once a change happens in a source system, automatically the change should reflect in my MDM. And for that reason being, I'll be using my real-time mode. Okay. For this scenario, I'll be using my mode like SIF. That is nothing but services integration framework. Services integration framework. So this is a mode where it helps us. Services helps us. This has been done via your web services. Web services. So this is with help of your SIF. I'll try to extract the data from my source system immediately once the change happened at my source level and push the data to my MDM Hub console via using your real-time mode. So for this you need assistance for 24/7. I'm sorry, 24/7. Because we do not know when there's a change happens at the source system. So there should be a person always present to monitor the jobs. But for this one, it's not the case. Because since it's a scheduled one, you can schedule, you can pre-plan beforehand. Yes, tomorrow is my load. Okay, this is okay. Of this week, on particular day, on so and so time, my load runs. So since it's scheduled one, so you can prepare beforehand. You can plan about this particular part, but for this real-time mode, we are not sure when this particular jobs will run. So this is a little bit hectic part because it's not only like using you should be by 24/7, but it also works on web services. It's totally your internet traffic. Okay, so this is like with internal tool level, but this is like based upon your real-time level. Okay, so maximum cases in real-time projects, you can see 95% of your real-time project will be available in batch mode, and like around I can say 3 to 5% or 5% of the projects will be on real-time mode. So it's totally purely based upon the requirement of your project or decision taken by your architecture. Okay, so this is the two modes where we try to extract the data from my source system and finally push my data to my Hub console, MDM Hub console. So from here to this thing, this hexagon is my Informatica Hub console, MDM. So the data will not be directly pushed into my Hub console, but in between I'll be having my either real-time mode or batch mode. That means either you'll be using ETL tool to extract the data from source system and push my data to my MDM Hub, or you use SIF. That means it's your real-time mode to extract the data from source system and push it to your Informatica MDM Hub console. Okay. So now till now I'm saying that I'll be pushing the data to my MDM Hub console. So where do we push the data? So do we have anything, a point or a point of contact so that I can push the data over there only, or can I push it anywhere? So what's the scenario over here? So here I'd like to introduce my first table in Informatica MDM that's called as your landing table. So landing table, I would say that this is the entry point of your to your MDM. This is the entry point to your MDM. So if you want to insert any data into your MDM Hub console, for sure you should insert into your landing table only. So now, how would the structure of the landing table will be? That's the next question. So let's see with a small example. Suppose I'm having a source system called CKR. At the same time, I'm having a source system called as MLO. So I'm having like a column called as ID column and a name column. Whereas in my MLO source system also, I'll be having my ID column and my name column. So in this, I'll be writing like 1011 John. And here I'll be having like 1011 or like 12 John K. Okay, so this is the two source system which is providing thing, that is a store one and store two, where you purchase, this is the store one where you purchased your prepaid SIM, and this is the store two where you purchased your postpaid SIM, source two. So now what happened, like I'll be pushing the data from my store one as well as my store two, that means source one and source two, to my landing table of my Informatica MDM. So now the structure of my landing table will be like this. So it also contain like ID and name. So in that reason being, what happened, like, so in between, what I'll use here, I'll use my either ETL or SIF. So using either ETL or SIF, what I'm trying to do, I'm pushing my data to my landing table. So in this, I'll be having my data like 1011 John and 12 John K. So now this is how your landing table will be. So landing table is nothing but it contains the data coming from my all the source system, one from CKR and one from my MLO. But if you see here in the landing table, you cannot differentiate the data. Suppose I want to see the data only coming from my MLO source system. So do we have any option to see only for MLO over here? So can you differentiate the data over here? No. Then how could I do that? For that reason being, what happens, like, we will try to add one more new column called as SRC or other name of the column as per your standards wallet in the company or project. So this one will contain my now CKR, or this will contain now MLO. Now, yes, I can clearly say that John K is coming from my MLO source system, where John is coming from my CKR source system. So this is how your landing table structure will be. Fine. So now, once the data is available in my landing table, what next? So if you compare with the Power Center, I would say that landing table is nothing but it's like a landing directory where you get all your flat files, all your source files. Okay, so what we'll do after getting the data into your landing table? So once I have my data in my landing table, now I'm able to get the data from all my source system. So what next? Next is like, I like to standardize my data. Suppose if you see here, John is in capital letter. As per my standard requirement, I don't want to have in capital letter, but I want to have in initial capital letter, like capital J, small O, small H, and small N. Similar to that, even this also I want to make a change like this. So how could I make a change of standard the data in my, which is cutting from my landing table? For that reason being, what I'll do, I have a technique in between टू मेक अ चेंज ऑफ माई डेटा आई हैव अ टेक्निक. सो लेट मी गेट बैक टू माई ओरिजिनल डेटा ऑफ ये जॉन के एंड जॉन ओवर हियर. सो नाउ व्हाट आई विल डू, सो आई विल ट्राई टू यूज अ टेक्निक लाइक कॉल्ड एज मैपिंग. सो मैपिंग इज अ टेक्निक वेयर आई विल ट्राई टू मेक माई डेटा चेंजेस एज पर माई रिक्वायरमेंट एंड फाइनली पुश माई डेटा टू सम अदर टारगेट्स एंड दैट टारगेट इज कॉल्ड एज योर स्टेज टेबल्स. It's called as your, so second one I can say like it's a stage tables. So number of stage tables will be number of source system. For that reason being, since I'm having two source systems over here, so I'll be having two stage tables. So let me write down that as well. So one is like stg underscore, this is for my CKR source system, and one more stage table over here I'll be having, that's nothing but stg underscore mlo source system, and each one has its own so again your columns like id and name, and here as well I'll be having my id and name. So in this, so while using the mapping technique, in between what I'll try to do, I'll try to make a change of my data, and finally I'll be having like 1011 and I'll be having like John, and in here 1012, and I'll be having like capital K. So this is how I could standardize my data as per my requirement, as the requirement of my client. So how do I change my data from my main data to this? By using my technique called as mapping. So in mapping, what I used, my cleanse function. So the data from a landing table to my stage table will be sent using my mapping, and in between mapping, what I'll try to do, I'll try to use my cleanse functions so that I can change the data format as per my requirement and push it to your main target stage tables over here. So it's not only like cleaning the data or like converting the data to one format or other format, but also you can use multiple tasks over there, like rejecting the data, or like rejecting the data means like you can reject the data as per your requirement. Suppose I'm having null value for name call. If there is a null value, then yes, I want to reject my data. So do not go to my stage table. I want to reject my data. So all such kind of things can be done within your mapping. So either cleansing or rejecting the data, or like also I can would say like delta detection. So I'll let me write down. Over here. So when we are pushing the data from landing table to stage table, what we do? We would apply cleanse functions like cleaning the data, everything. Cleaning the data or substituting the data, whatever you want. So you can apply all this over here. Okay, so cleanse functions, as well as you can also apply your delta detection. I'll tell you what is delta detection, and so what is a delta detection over here. So let's try to see what is a delta detection, and then we can come back again to our main flow. Delta detection. So this is something like generally people who are working in Informatica Powers and should already be, will know about this particular process, but people who are not there, do not worry, we'll try to explain what it is now. Suppose at my source system, I have a source and I have my target over here. Suppose in the source system, I have my data like 1011, John over here. Now, what I'll do like, I'll simply try to compare my source data with my target data. Okay, let me write down my call names as well. ID and name over here. So now what I'll do, I need to know whether the source row is existing in the target or not, or I could say it's my landing stage table, and this is my source will be my landing table. Okay, so I like to know that if the source record is existing in the stage table or not. If it is existing, then is there any change in the so other columns or not. Suppose like 1011 is the key to my particular customer over here. So what I'll do, like I'll try to add a condition like if landing table or like LND dot ID is equal to my STG dot ID. That means what happens here, like 1011 is equal to, so do we have any data over here? No, right? If you do not have any data, that means it will provide like null value. So no value over here. That means this condition is failed. So when this is failed, that means it's a new row coming from my source. And what we need to do? And we need to insert the data into stage table, right? So for that reason being, what I will do, based upon this condition, what I did, I simply inserted my data into my stage table over here. So for the first time, I just inserted my data over here. Now for the second time, what happened, like I had the data like from John became like John K, and also have one more record like 1022, and this is like some Steve. Okay, some Steve. So now again, what happens, like based upon this condition, I'll go and check it out. So like 1011 equals to, yes, now I can find a match over here, right? For that reason being, now I have 1011. That means here my condition got passed. My condition got passed, and this says that it is an old record in the target or in the stage table. And what we need to do, and we need to update the record, right? So now again, the second row comes into picture. Now that nothing but your 1022. So this one again, I don't found any matches in my stage table. For that reason being, this is again failed. So it's a new record coming from the source system, and I need to insert my data into my target. So finally, now what you say, like I can see a new record inserted and old record got updated. Okay, so till now we understood that if there's a match, it's an old record. If there is no match, it's a new record to be inserted or updated in my target table or stage table over here. So now, next. Third time, I got one more record like 033 and some Dale. If you observe now, 1011 again matches with my 1011, correct? And the condition is passed. So it's an old record in the stage table, and we need to update the record as per the process. But if you observe here, there is no change in my name column over here. There's no change in my name column. Even though the row exists over here, you don't see any change in my name column. For that reason being, such kind of records are not taken as update. So I like to add one more extra condition over here, that we need to update the record only if there is a change in the non-keys columns. Only when there is a change in the non-key columns, else I will not update. If there is no change, I will not update. Okay, so that's how we work. Now if you see here, Dale 103 is like a new record, it's not present in over here. For that reason being, what I'll do, I'll simply insert my data again into my source system. So now I would say that a delta detection means the landing table will be compared with my stage table for sure. And if there's a data existing like this, I would check not only about the key, but also I'll check the other columns as well. So if there is a no change, then yes, I will not update my data, and such records will not be considered as a delta record. So not considered as delta record. Next, this one, yes, this is a record that is not present at my target table. This record does not present at my stage table. For that reason being, yes, I will consider as delta record. So if there's a change, then yes, I will consider as a delta record. So three things over here. The one thing is like new record, which is not present in my target table, is this considered as your delta record? Old record with updates, this is will be considered as delta record. Third thing is like old record with no update. So this will not be considered as delta record. Okay, so delta record means when you compare your source and target, if it is not existing, then it's a new row to insert. This I'll consider as a delta record. If the data is existing in the target table, yes, only it has been considered delta record only when there is a change in my other column. That means only old records with updates. So if you see here, this one, no change. This one is not exist, does not exist. This is a new record. This is a total new record. This is the old record with no change. And some other one, you can go with like, suppose Steve record as well, like 1022. So if you see here, this will also consider as my delta record, because this is the existing record. This is the existing record, and you can see that there is a change in my name over here. There's a change in my name over here. So this is how you can have the things here. So one is like new record, other one is like old record with update, another one is like old record without update. So this will not be considered as a delta record, but these two will be considered as a delta record, because this is the old one which is having update in it, and this is totally new, and this is the old record still, but there is no update in that. For that reason being, this is not being declared as a delta record, but only these two will be considered in the second run. So this will be simply ignored. This will not be updated into your target table, but these two will be considered, because there's a change, and one is new record, other one is like changed record. So this is about your delta detection concept. So using this concept, this concept can be available at your mapping level. So when we're pushing the data from your landing table to stage table, we would apply cleanse functions and or you can also say or. If you want, you can go with, it's not a mandatory part again. So you can go with your delta detection. Okay, so this is how the things happen when you move the data from your landing table to your finally stage tables. Next, if you observe here, that's what you can see here. So using your ETL tool or some SIF, you try to move the data from a landing table to my stage table over here using my mapping technique. And in this mapping technique, in this is called as my stage process. So under stage process, I can apply my cleanse functions or my delta detection. Okay. So now, if you see here, you can see some kind of reject table over here, this reject and raw. So what are these? So these are nothing but the tables which are being created automatically by your Informatica MDM when you create a stage table. Okay, when you create a stage table, this reject table for sure, it will be created, and raw table and some other two tables will be created. That will be created only when you create your mapping level. So let me write down that as well. So when we create a stage table, when we create a stage table, four tables are created by Informatica MDM. So among the four tables, one table, or I can say like the first one, reject table, is being created when you create a stage table. When you create a stage table, I would say that, okay. So when you create a stage table, I would say that apart from four, I can say one table is being created by Informatica MDM, and that table is called as your reject table. When we create a stage table, one table is being created and that table is called as your reject table. So now, when you create your mapping, that means you have a landing table and you have a stage table. When you create the mapping between a particular landing table and a stage table, then we can see three more tables. That means three more. So second one is like, it will be raw table. Third one, you can see like PRL, or I can say it's like a previous landing table will be created. And final one, you can have OPL table. It's a online previous landing table. Online previous landing table, OPL. Okay. So this is about, these are the four tables which are totally related to your, okay, I wrote here. Okay. These are four tables are totally related to your reject table. So let me write down here, just here. Okay. So once you create a stage table, one new table will be created for you. That is table is called as your reject table. And once you create your mapping between your landing and stage, then three more tables will be created for you. So now, what is the use of these tables? Why your Informatica MDM is creating such tables over here? Okay. So the first one is like reject table. So reject table is very common table, like it contains all your rejected data. Okay, see here what happened here, like when you're trying to move the data, so you have applied all the functions, all the cleansing techniques, everything, and finally what you did, like you are trying to move the data from a landing table to my stage table. So you here, you applied all the functions, data detection, everything, and you're trying to move the data from my landing table to my stage table. Suppose there is some kind of issue in between, like some kind of primary key violation or some kind of data translation errors or some kind of foreign key primary key relationship errors. Due to some issue, the data may be rejected, which is coming from a source system and supposed to be inserted into my target table. So that meta data will not be inserted into my target table, that or stage table, because it got rejected due to some violations. So now, where could I see the data which has been rejected? So that data which has been rejected, you can see that at my reject table. So reject table helps us to capture all of my rejected data when you are trying to push the data from my landing table to my stage table. But we should make sure that our reject table, whatever the data you contains over there, we should make sure that should clear all the data. That means you should think about why it got rejected, what happened to that, and you should make sure that you should push it that to my next level tables. Because if you miss a single customer in the reject table, then yes, we are missing a customer. So we'll be in big trouble because the whole business runs on customer only, right? So reject table is very important for us over here. So next is like raw table. So what is a raw table over here? So if you see here, we can see one more like raw table. So suppose think that if you see here, nothing is in files, everything in tables. You have a landing table, you have a stage table, you have a reject table, right? Everything in tables. So now suppose think that I ran my January month frequency. It's a batch mode I'm going with, and I ran for January month data, I ran for February month, March, April, and now supposing that you are in May month. So now suddenly client came up to us saying that I missed one of the customer called like Diljo. Some customer called like Diljo, where I'm expecting this customer to come in January month, but till now I did not saw any row regarding that particular customer. So now what happened to my customer? So what you will do? So before getting into my logics, what you wrote in your mappings over here, before getting into the logic, the first step is like we need to understand like, do this customer really came in January month data or not? Correct. So if you have the customer in your January month data, then yes, go and check it out in your logic what you wrote in the mapping level. Maybe it got filtered out due to some issues, or maybe it is available in your reject table. We're not sure. So the first step, what I told you, like we need to have the data of your January month. But see, since you all these are table level, you do not do any kind of archiving of data. You will not do any kind of archiving of data. Okay, so now how could I get my data for this now? So you see here, so for that reason being, I need to request my source system to have my data for January month, because as of now I'm in May month and I need to request my data from my source system. So either you need to wait until your source system responses, or you need directly go to your source database and get the data from there. But some source systems will be in such a typical manner that they do not give you access to the database 24/7. So you need to wait until a specific time. Until then, after that, you need to fire a query in the database and get it back. But up to that particular time level, your client may not have patience. So he wants the results immediately. So in order to avoid such kind of situations, not to be dependent upon your source system, why could I store some kind of data in my MDM level? Or have some kind of historical data in my MDM level? In that scenario, in order to have your data, historical data, like past 5 months or past 1 year of data. So in order to have all such kind of data, directly raw data, which is directly coming from a source system. Okay. So it's not like after getting cleanse functions, everything applied to that, I'm just trying to store the data which is coming from a landing table. So in order to have that, I have my raw table over here. Raw table, right? So raw table, nothing but it is a table. It helps us to store your historical data for certain period of time. It may be 5 months, or it may be like 2 loads. It may be you can talk on the basis of your loads. Like I want to store the past 5 loads, or latest 5 loads, or latest 10 loads. Or you can talk about the time duration. Like I want to store my data for the past 1 month. So you may run 100 loads in the particular month. All those data will be available in your raw table. So that's how. So when you want to archive the data, when you want to have the backup of your data, then yes, you go with your raw table. This is all are optional. If you really need it, then only you go with. Okay. So that's about the raw table. And third thing is like PRL. So previous landing table. So this is the table where it comes into picture when you go with your delta detection option. So earlier we spoke about delta detection, right? So this will comes into picture when you have your delta detection option. So this one, I told like there is a comparison done will be done between your landing table and your stage table. But in real time, the comparison will not be done directly between landing and staging. But in between, I'll be having one more table called as my PRL table, where this comparison will be done between my PRL and landing. If it is really changes have happened, those changes will be sent to my stage table. So PRL table, stage table, and your landing table. So these are the main things. So landing table and your PRL table will be compared. So once the changes are is done, then it will be sent to my stage table. If the changes are done, I mean the data is existing record but there's no changes, then it will be ignored in my PRL table only and it will not be sent to my stage table. So you do not have any kind of separate job for this to move the data from a PRL to stage again. So the whole process will be done under single shot. That is nothing but your stage job. It's nothing but your stage job. So when you enable your delta detection option, then automatically PRL table comes into picture. And the, for the first time, the data from your landing table will be pushed to my PRL. Pushed to your PRL. I mean, because there's no data in your PRL for the first time, right? For the first time, you will be having the data in your landing table and you don't have any data in your PRL table. At the same time, you don't have any data in your stage table as well for the first time. So once the comparison has been done between your landing and PRL, so what happened like 1011 equals to null, 1033 equals to null, 1022 equals to null. That means there is no data for, that means all the three records will be considered as the new records and that will be inserted into my PRL first and from there, that will be inserted to my stage table. Okay, later part when I rerun again, so what I'll do, I'll try to compare my earlier data, my new data of landing table with my early data in the PRL, and if it is existing and there is a change, then yes, that particular record will be passed to my stage table. If it is a new record, that will be passed. If it is existing and there's no change, such records will be ignored at my PRL table and it will not be sent to my stage table. So that's how your PRL table helps. Okay, the similar way your OPL table also will be done when you go with your online. That means when you go with your SIF mode, then you use your OPL table. When you go with the batch mode, then you go with your PRL table. So PRL table comes into picture only when you enable your delta detection option. Else it, this will not come into picture and the data will be directly pushed from a landing table to my stage table in when you do not opt for delta detection. If you opt for delta detection, then surely PRL table comes into picture in between. So comparison will be done between your PRL table and your landing table and the resultant data what you got after this, that will be sent to your stage table. That I could say that the delta records, new records or like this record, these two such kind of records will be sent to my stage table and this kind of records will be hanged over at my PRL table itself. They will not be sent again to my stage table. That's all about my four tables which has been generated by default when you enable, when you create a stage table. Okay, so if the when you create a stage table, only reject table will be created, but when you create a mapping, then yes, the rest of the three tables will be created. So that's about my stage tables over here. So until this particular point, I'll stop over here. We'll continue this from tomorrow. So let's see how the data flows from a stage table to my other different tables and what is the other table we have to push the data from my staging table and what the process is called as and what we do in the third table when you push the data into over there. So let's talk all these things in the next session. Okay guys, hope you understood the things till now. Let's have the more details in next session. Have a great day guys. Bye bye.